Hello, and welcome to Virginia Time Travel, your portal of the Commonwealth's past, present, and future. It's the 150th anniversary of the Civil War, and as we begin to look back on this particular time period in history, if you go to almost any newspaper or news website, you're going to probably find at least one article that goes ahead almost every week, or if not every month, that talks about the 150th anniversary of blank. Could be almost any number of things. Could be causes of the war, how they're still being fought today. Could be a famous individual doing something. In fact, sometimes a lot of historians like to go ahead and point out it was on this date that such and such had done such and that. In a lot of ways, this always comes up rather interestingly enough as topics for debate amongst historians and Civil War buffs. Well, today we're going to go ahead and have ourselves a little chat about some of the more famous Virginian generals who were found in the Civil War, particularly for the Confederacy. And so joining me once again today is Don Hakenson, author of the books That This Forgotten Land, Volumes 1 and 2, and not to mention also a Mosby enthusiast, and basically the man who's the who's who of Confederates here in Northern Virginia. So Don, welcome back.
Thank you.
Now, we get to go ahead and talk today about a lot of the generals. Of course, we have the big name generals we know of, but we're going to start off with, I think, a general nobody's heard of. We were talking about him before off camera, and you know what? It's such a great story. Let's kick it off with him. So, the guy no one's ever heard of, Samuel Cooper. What can you tell us?
Well, Samuel Cooper was the adjutant general of the United States Army, and he served 40 years in the United States Army. And when the states started seceding in March of 1861, Samuel Cooper resigns his commission and joins the Confederate Army. 40 years. He was born in New York. He was a Yankee. Why do you think he resigned his commission and joined the Confederate government?
I couldn't even remotely tell you.
He was married to a descendant of George Mason. and she had strong Virginia ties. And I guess he just couldn't fight against her ancestors. So he resigned his commission because his wife was a descendant of George Mason from Gunston Hall. And that's a really neat story. Now, the interesting thing about Samuel Cooper was, at the beginning of the war, he was the ranking officer, the ranking general in the Confederate Army. And he's buried at Christ Church Cemetery on Wilkes Street in Alexandria.
How do you like that?
Yeah.
Now, when you look at a lot of these generals, I mean, here's this one guy nobody's ever heard of. Now we got his name out there. Who knows how many people might want to do a quick Google search. But obviously, there are the big name people, the ones that we all know of. We've seen the portraits. We've seen photographs. We have everything about them. In fact, the first two men I talk about, there's a famous story about George Patton involving these men, where as a child he looked up and he saw these two men and he thought they were God and Jesus respectively, Robert E. Lee and Thomas Jonathan Jackson. And so let's go ahead and begin, of course, with the ranking of the two, that being General Lee. Now, for Robert E. Lee, son of famous Henry Light Horse Harry Lee, native Virginian, of course his father dies in ill repute. So Lee really has to work to build up his reputation. He marries the daughter of George Washington Parke Custis, step-grandson to George Washington. This is a guy who, realistically speaking, should be through and through USA number one in the blue. Why is he in the gray?
Well, he was a Virginian. He was born at Stratford Hall in Albemarle County. The family moved to Alexandria, I believe, when he was either 2 to 4 years old. He was a young kid. And he loved Alexandria, and he loved Virginia, and his family was steeped in the history of the state of Virginia. And he was asked to be the commander-in-chief of the Union Army, and because they were asking him to fight against his mother's state of Virginia, he couldn't do it. He just flat out couldn't do it, and he had to turn it down. And I could just see him agonizing over that decision, because here was an honor. They were asking him to be the commander-in-chief of the United States Army, something that he was very proud of, and something that he he loved the Army. He was the superintendent at West Point. He loved everything about it. But he also realized that he couldn't pull his sword against his mother's state, and he turned down that offer. That tells you a lot about Robert E. Lee. Really does.
Mm-hmm. And when you go to Arlington House, they tell you the story of the famous pacing in the room throughout the night, mm-hmm. making the decision. Now, when we think of Robert E. Lee, we think the white hair, the beard, we have a very distinctive image of him. However, what seems rather peculiar is you don't see the beard until 1862, and in the only early known image of him, he's got the mustache. So do we know actually when he grew the beard?
I'm really not sure. My feeling is it occurred in 1862, sometime during that period. He was a very handsome man when he was younger. He was very dashing. But he was a very handsome man when he grew his beard. And one of the things, whenever I think of Robert E. Lee, I think about a story that I was told dealing with General Grant. Grant has just taken over as the commander of the Army of the Potomac. And he's going to take on Lee for the very first time at the Wilderness in May of 1864. And he's going to teach Robert E. Lee and the Army of Northern Virginia a lesson. And in that engagement, he has over 100,000 men. Lee has somewhere between 50,000 to 60,000 to 70,000 men. And he's in his headquarters, and all these Union officers keep running in and say, Bobby Lee's going to do this. Bobby Lee's going to do that. Another guy, Bobby Lee's going to do this, and Bobby Lee's going to do that. And Grant has had enough of this. And he says, quit telling me what Bobby Lee is going to do, and start telling me what you're going to do to Bobby Lee. Now, that really tells you what the Union Army thought of Robert E. Lee. They had a respect for the Army of Northern Virginia and the commander of that army. And I think that's a real good illustration of what the enemy thought of Bobby Lee.
I've heard the famous story too about stop telling me what he's going to do, what we're going to do. Now, only thing is that, you know, in 1862 he's called Granny Lee.
Well, he was an engineer. And he believed that in fortifications and preparing for the enemy. And at that point in time, in late 61, early 62, the state of Virginia and the citizens, they wanted victories. They wanted to see things happen. And training and preparing and defenses was not what the people wanted to see. And Bobby Lee, being an officer who had spent his career in the military, he was an engineer, he understood the importance of defense. And a lot of the people who wanted to see victories and wanted to see immediate fights, they didn't appreciate General Lee at that time, and they called him Granny Lee.
Of course, he proved to be a very ferocious general when actually engaged.
Everywhere General Lee went, casualties followed him. He was a very aggressive commander. Absolutely. And anybody that called him Granny Lee after the what occurred outside of Richmond in June of 1862, that thinking changed.
Yeah. Now, for General Lee, he's been referred to as the greatest general never to win a war. How would you classify him?
I'm a Virginian, so I've got to state that for the record. I grew up in Fairfax County, and when I was a little boy, everything was Robert E. Lee. But when you have to study somebody on what they accomplished, well, his victories at the 7 Days Campaign, or the battles right outside of Richmond, where he took all of his forces and he put them on one side of the Chickahominy, and he took a gamble. And the Army in Northern Virginia could have been destroyed at that point, and he attacked. But McClellan, as soon as Lee attacked, McClellan ordered a retreat. He another gamble was at Chancellorsville, where he ordered Jackson on his flank movement. He split his army in front of a superior numerical numbers, and it worked. He didn't have the supplies, he didn't have the men that the Union Army had, and yet he accomplished great things. I consider him one of the greatest generals in the history of this country, and I also consider him one of the greatest Americans, because he went into that war knowing the South could not win. But yet he threw everything he had into supporting Virginia. And he also was very loyal to Jefferson Davis. Davis had Beauregard and Davis had General Johnston before Lee. And a lot of times Davis would wake up in the morning and he'd open up the newspapers and he'd see a quote from Beauregard of what he was going to do, and that would infuriate Davis. And the same thing with Johnston, and Johnston was called the retreating general. But they were always talking to the newspapers instead of talking to him. They were not keeping him informed. Well, Robert E. Lee, he didn't talk to the newspapers. He kept his commander-in-chief informed about what he was doing, and he didn't have to worry about him popping off the newspapers. So he was very loyal, and any commander-in-chief today would love somebody who kept a person informed and wasn't in front of the newspaper cameras all the time.
Well, certainly there is that to be learned. Now,
also, I want to point out that he was a very brilliant man, and when he graduated from West Point, he graduated number 2 in his class and didn't have a single demerit.
That's impressive.
Yeah, that is impressive.
That's an impressive feat. Unfortunately, we can't say much about a lot of students today having that same kind of record.
The funny thing, the ironic thing, is that Lee had a son who was number 1 at West Point.
Oh.
He beat his father.
Oh, I can only imagine the dinner table conversation after that. So, Dad, number 1, mm-hmm. What were you getting? That's a little salt in the wound there. Now, I'm curious to know, we have 2 very famous films. We have Gettysburg, Gods and Generals, Martin Sheen, Robert Duvall. Who did better?
Oh, that's no contest. No contest. Duvall is Lee. Martin Sheen made Robert E. Lee look weak and did not portray the leadership and the type of man that Robert E. Lee was. And I was very disappointed when I watched the movie Gettysburg on Sheen playing Lee. Duvall was a stronger man. Robert E. Lee, like I said earlier, everywhere he went, casualties followed him because he was an aggressive commander. And he was beloved. You know, all these casualties, yet he was beloved by his men. And this was during the war and after the war. One of the most beloved generals in the history of this country.
Well, certainly he is that. Now, where Lee is certainly the brain center, we have Jackson. Thomas Jonathan Jackson. Most people don't even realize his name was Thomas or had Jonathan in there. We only think of him as Stonewall. Now, very religious man. Some would argue he's pretty much insane.
Interesting guy.
A very interesting guy. He used to hold up a hand in order to level out the blood flow. What can you tell us about him?
Well, Jackson got his nickname, as you know, at First Manassas. There's a couple stories about, there stands Jackson like a stone wall, rally behind the Virginians. You know, and that's, he's supporting the fight. There's another story that some people believe, that there stands Jackson doing nothing. it all depends on which way you want to look at it. Being a Virginian, I really believe that B, who is credited with saying this, is a Colonel B, that he really meant there's Jackson standing like a stone wall, rally behind them, and they did. But B gets killed. But Jackson comes out with his brigade and saves the day at Henry Hill. And he makes that name Stonewall becomes famous. And not only did it become famous, he became feared. And whenever I think of Jackson, there's another little story that comes to mind that gives you the flavor about Jackson. Jackson understood that war was not a game. And he knew it had nothing to do with romance. It had to do with killing people. He was a Mexican War veteran. He was breveted twice for gallantry during the Mexican War, and he understood that war was brutal. and it was horrific. But here's a story that really illustrates the type of man that Jackson is. There's a Union officer, and he's on the other side of a creek, and he's riding a white horse, and they're actually engaged against Baldy Ewell's unit. Mm-hmm. And this officer is displaying gallantry, riding on this white horse back and forth, directing his men what to do. And Baldy Ewell is very impressed about the gallantry of this Union officer. So he finally tells his men to honor the bravery of that man. He says, don't shoot at him. We want to honor his bravery on the battlefield. And this is what Baldy Ewell wanted to do. He wanted to honor this man who was displaying great courage on the other side of that creek, directing fire against the Confederates. Jackson comes up riding on his horse, Little Sorrel. And he sees this white horse and this Union officer going back and forth, and nobody's firing at him. And he dismounts from Little Sorrel, and he goes up to General Ewell and says, General Ewell, why aren't you firing at that Union officer? And Baldy Ewell looks at General Jackson. He says, we are honoring his bravery. And Jackson gets this look on his face, and he says, I want you to kill that man, and I want you to kill him now. You kill the brave, and the weak will run. That is General Jackson.
There's certainly a way to go ahead and do things. Now, a lot of people said he was sometimes a little reckless. I mean, his foot cavalry would do anything he told them to do. I mean, if he said, charge a wall and just keep ramming into it until it falls down, they probably would have done it. Now, at Chancellorsville, he rides out to scout ahead, and coming back, he gets shot by his own men. Now, did his own men know that it was one of their own that fired the shot? Did rumor ever leak out, or was it one of those very well-kept secrets?
No, if it ever was a secret, for the people who don't know, it was the 18th North Carolina Infantry that fired the fatal shot. And so we did a Civil War tour about a year ago. We went to Chancellorsville, and we had a gentleman whose descendant was from a North Carolina unit. And I got to tell the story about Jackson being mortally wounded. And so I knew the guy. His name is Penny. I said, Penny, I bet you 10-1 your relative was in the 18th North Carolina, wasn't he? And he goes, yes, he was, Don. So it was really funny on the tour. But it was the 18th North Carolina that fired the fatal shot. They did not know it was Jackson and his staff. A.P. Hill is also wounded, who would go on to become the 3rd Corps commander of the Army of Northern Virginia. Jackson would die. A.P. Hill would survive. But it was the 18th North Carolina.
If only it could have been the other way around, who knows what history would have looked like.
Well, now, a lot of people said that if Jackson hadn't died, things might have changed at Gettysburg. Well, it's, you know, if ifs and nuts, you know, you never know. I try to look at facts. I'm not into this what would have and what could have. Lee did not have Jackson. He had Baldy Ewell, who took over the 2nd Corps. He had A.P. Hill, who had the 3rd Corps. He had Longstreet, who was in the 1st Corps. Those were pretty competent commanders. They failed at Gettysburg, though.
Now, as I mentioned before, guys and generals, Stephen Lang portraying Jackson. What do you think?
I thought he did a great job. I think he stole the picture. There's a lot of people that said, Don, that movie was done from the southern side. And, you know, I didn't like that. And I said, you know, I actually did like it. I thought it was very well done. I thought Stephen Lang played a very impressive Jackson. The movie was long, but you had to cover some significant battles in that movie, and I really think that Gods and Generals, to be honest with you, I love both movies. I love Gettysburg, and I love Gods and Generals, and there's a lot of people that they saw blemishes in Gods and Generals. I was one of the few people that actually enjoyed it, and I actually enjoyed both movies. I just did not enjoy Martin Sheen as Lee, and that was the only complaint that I had.
Well, I enjoyed both movies myself, too, so we're in the same camp on that one. I thought it was very good. I thought they did a good job.
Oh, I thought they did a tremendous job.
I wish they'd released the director's cut where they showed the Battle of Antietam, but if that happened, it's an eight-hour-long film.
That's right.
But, you know, Stephen Lang also portrayed another Confederate general, somebody that I like to talk about just a little bit, and that's George Pickett. He played Pickett in Gettysburg, and so, you know, one of the things how would you say he portrayed Pickett? Do you think Pickett was probably portrayed? There's a famous scene where they're playing card. He says, "We don't bow down to any gang. I got three kings right here, Jimmy." And that's just, you got to think, is that the Pickett that Lang is portraying is correctly, or is this just Lang having fun?
There's a lot of things about Pickett. Pickett's a very interesting guy. When you talk about Pickett, and I'm not talking about the movie now, it always goes back to Pickett's charge. What happened on Pickett's charge? Should they have attacked? They did. Lee believed that the center was weak. It was not weak. Pickett's charge was a complete and utter failure. Lee meets the troops that are coming back and says, "It's my fault." Lee took responsibility for that. But he did hold Pickett responsible. And during the siege of Petersburg, Lee is riding along the road, and here comes Pickett, and Pickett rides by. And Lee turns to one of his staff, and he says, "Is that man still in my army?" So a lot of people think, well, Pickett had nothing to blame. Lee took responsibility for what happened because he gave the order. Longstreet didn't like it. He tried to talk Lee out of it. But Lee did blame Pickett. He really did.
I remember in my own Civil War class at Mason, our professor said that's the closest Lee has ever come to insulting an officer is that one particular quote. But you know, I have my own quote too, and it's a pretty darn good one as well. I don't know if you've heard the story. There's a story of Pickett riding in a carriage with Sickles at one of the anniversaries for Gettysburg. I think it was in 1890. Have you heard this story before?
No.
Okay. Oh, I finally got one. And so they're riding in there together. They're both kind of, like commiserating a little bit together because everyone's kind of hounding Pickett because he lost. And Sickles, of course, he's very famous for his own regards. And so everyone started giving Pickett that famous, you know, the famous question was, well, what if Pickett did this? Or what if you had done that? Or what if that is blah, 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 blah. Well, Pickett finally had enough of it. And he said, "You know what? I think the Federal Army had something to do with it."
There's another story. John Singleton Mosby and George Pickett went to see Lee after the war. And they rode up to Lee's house, and Mosby dismounted, and Pickett stayed on his horse. And Mosby said, "Aren't you getting off the horse to go see Lee?" And he said, "That man destroyed my division." And Mosby looked at him, and he said, yes, he did, but he made you immortal. That's a neat story.
That's a neat story too, because he's right about that. I mean, You go to Gettysburg. What's the one thing everyone wants to see? Pickett's charge.
Absolutely. I walked the ground. I retired from the Department of the Army after 37 years, and I got to go on a staff ride where we walked up to Cemetery Ridge, and walked on the same ground of Pickett's charge, and I'll never forget that. And I was really glad I worked for the Department of the Army, and I got to do that.
I walked Pickett's charge myself, and kind of understanding the field. And it was winter time; it was muddy, and so while the weather was like the complete opposite of what they had, it slowed you down just enough to kind of get you there. And so, one last guy, just to kind of mention Armistead, the famous charge and the high tide of the Confederacy. Is there any little anecdote, like really short, that you know of him?
Well, there's a whole lot of things that come to mind. Right offhand, he was friends with General Hancock, who was a Union general that was right there at Cemetery Ridge. And Hancock is wounded. And he makes it over the high water mark, which is the stone wall, Armistead does. And he's mortally wounded there. And when people come around him and he's captured and he's wounded, he says, How's Hancock? I want to know, how's Hancock? Who is his best friend that was a Union officer who was wounded there on Cemetery Ridge? So he was more concerned about Hancock and his health than his own. And I thought that's tells you a lot about Louis Armistead.
I think it does too. I mean, it does say a lot. And yeah, there's a lot to be said about it, but probably one of the most interesting things is, you know, we've mentioned the films Gods and General and Gettysburg. What most people might not realize about Gettysburg is this. The actor who portrayed the role of Louis Armistead died 1 month after the completion of the film. And so for him, and that famous charge up towards the high tide of the Confederacy, and his own passing away seems to almost mirror the real life image. And so in a lot of ways, he becomes immortal in that own regard. But he learned more about Don and that which he's done for the Civil War history. Of course, there are his books, This Forgotten Land, Volume 1 and 2. To learn more about that, please visit our website, www.timetravel21.com, or email us at timetravel21@yahoo.com. This has been Virginia Time Travel, your portal of the Commonwealth's past, present, and future. Thank you for tuning in, and we hope to see you all once again.